Hi, Nathan.
G'day, Barbara. How are you?
Fine. A lot of stuff came up for me in the last week after our last talk.
Yeah.
So I'd like to cover a little bit of that today.
Sure.
But look, firstly, thank you for doing part two on this subject with us today on abortion.
Yeah.
In part one, we covered lots of material on the subject, and you answered lots of questions. You elaborated on current worldviews, you explained God's truth on all of the subjects of judgment, morals, definitions, religious views, legal status, statistics, miscarriage, stillbirth, prem births, rights of the unborn child, free will, soul attachment, afterlife, soul damage, repentance, contraception in part, I want to cover a bit of that today, and adoption in part, I'd like to cover today.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Yeah. So you covered lots of ground in such a short time last week.
Mm-hmm.
I have to say that I was overwhelmed with most of the information you shared with me last week.
Right.
So in that overwhelming, it affected my delivery a bit, and I skipped over some things.
So you'd like to ask?
Yeah, I'd like to just go back and cover a few things that I think might complete that whole part one before we go on to part two.
Sure, sounds good.
Okay. Well, so today, I think we'll do that, start with that, and then I'd like to share my personal experience, and then I'll do some hypotheticals.
Okay, that sounds good.
Okay. So, you did cover this in lots of little different arrangements last week, but just straight and simple. And you might want to elaborate on these six questions I've got. You might want to elaborate a little bit on knowing what you already covered, or you might want to, you know, expand even further.
Sure.
But, you know, the main question is, how does God view abortion?
Well, firstly, I think we need to preface that answer too with the use of the English language and other languages on earth and judgment associated with specific words. So when we say specific words here on earth, there's a tendency to have a lot of judgment associated with those particular words. But in the spirit world and also for God, there is no judgment associated with those words. It's just a fact rather than a judgment. So it's if we can consider that here on earth, if you're speeding a car, for example, in a car, there is a certain amount of judgment associated with the fact that you're speeding. If we just take it as a truth, you're either going over the speed limit, 101 in our case in Australia, kilometres an hour, is over the speed limit, and therefore you are classified as speeding. And we don't have to have any emotional judgment about that.
So I'm not a hoon.
Exactly. So, and if you go under 100 kilometres an hour, you know, you're not a slowpoke, that sort of thing. We don't have these judgments associated with those words. Those words, although on earth, connotate judgment. And so there are words, for example, like rape, murder, and so forth on earth that connotate judgment. So I want to preface that comment first, understanding that I don't have any judgment about the word I'm going to use to how God views these specific things. But in terms of what happens in terms of the soul condition of an individual, and what happens when they have an abortion, it is very similar to what happens to a murderer when a murderer chooses to murder somebody else. It's also very similar to what happens to a person who suicides as well, in the sense that they have murdered themselves. So from all three aspects, all of those three things, God considers exactly the same way. When I say exactly the same way, there are different flavours to it as to what were the underlying motives. If you consider what a murderer would choose to do, a murderer would choose to murder somebody else because of usually quite selfish motives. In other words, they have a justification list inside of themselves as to why they would choose to murder. And those justifications can include, oh, well, the person annoyed me, right up to, well, the person was going to threaten me with my life, and so I murdered him first. And anything in between, generally, as a justification. And it's very similar with regard to abortion as well. We have various justifications for committing acts of abortion. And of course, every one of those justifications has a different emotional component to it. And God doesn't lump all murderers in the same classification, because it all depends on the emotional reasons why they chose to commit such an act. Also, the soul condition of an individual, as we discussed in a previous seminar, if we commit an act that is below our current condition as a soul, our soul condition degrades. If we commit an act that's higher than our condition of love as a soul, then our soul condition improves. So if our soul condition is already at this point, and we can at a point where we would be willing to murder, and we actually commit a murder, then our soul condition would only degrade a little compared to what it was already at. And this is what we must bear in mind as well. It's the same with an abortion. So if our soul condition is at this level where we would consider killing someone under certain circumstances, and often we'd consider killing someone if our fear was involved or something else, or something was life-threatening and all those kind of things, that soul condition then determines the underlying action. So we need to understand that when I say that God sees a person who commits an abortion very similarly to a person who commits a murder, we must understand that God sees every single underlying causal emotional reason why such a person would take such an action, rather than just sort of seeing it as an act, as we have a tendency to do here on earth, seeing it as an act committed and therefore deserving of a certain sentence without any consideration, if you like, of any other factors. So this is something we must consider. But in terms of the underlying principles, taking somebody's life is not our right, as every single person has a gift of life. And if we take away their gift of life without their choice being involved, then of course we would never do it even if their choice was involved, generally, if they were alive, you know, in terms of a human that's living an adult, we wouldn't consider doing it. Then it's very much the same from God's perspective as regard to taking away a life of a person who's yet to be born, in other words, yet to exit the womb of their mother.
Okay. Thank you. The intention or desire versus taking the action, and I'll give you an example on that.
Mm-hmm.
If one or both of the pregnant couple really wants an abortion, but it doesn't happen, either because of the other party prevents it, or family prevent it, or the abortion technique fails, what is the penalty upon the soul of the souls of those who desire the abortion?
If someone desires the abortion, it is very, very similar as if they had already committed the abortion, mm-hmm. in terms of what effect it has upon their soul. As I've just explained, their soul must already be in a certain state for them to consider such an action. And so for that reason, their soul condition may not degrade too much further than where they currently are, but the fact that they would consider such an action is already stating the degradation of the soul in that condition. So the fact that I would consider murdering you in the first place is in itself a problem, as you can see, from an emotional perspective. So it's very similar for the parents involving an abortion. So let's say that the husband desires and tries to force his wife into committing an abortion. Then obviously the husband would already, in a lot of ways, be considered to be a murderer. Does that make sense? Even though the action has yet to be committed, the husband is already, in his actions and in his thoughts, a murderer. He wants to commit a murder. And while he hasn't carried through the action, or his wife hasn't carried through the action, if he, for example, left his wife on the basis of her not committing the abortion, then that would indicate that he was really desiring her to follow through on the action, and therefore the consequences of such an action, particularly when he arrives in the spirit world, would be very, very similar to as if he had already committed the abortion himself,
mm-hmm.
even if his wife chose not to commit the abortion and to go ahead with the pregnancy. If both parties decided to go ahead with the abortion but something failed, then both parties would be considered. If both parties decided to go ahead with the abortion but something failed, and then they they regretted the choice that they made, then already they're starting to improve their condition because they've gone through a feeling of regret and therefore some sense of repentance, although they may not have addressed the underlying emotional reason why they decided upon the abortion in the first place. Also, there is this factor that most people on earth don't have a clear understanding of when of the soul attaching to the body, and therefore they don't have a clear understanding of the pain associated with the abortion from the point of view of the child. And if they had much clearer understanding of those particular aspects of truth, then many people who initially consider abortion would probably not even consider it after that, after knowing those facts. So there is also a consideration from God of the level of ignorance the person remains in and what that ignorance is, where it's from, and who created that ignorance. So if the ignorance was created by society, then a portion of the blame for the abortion falls upon society. If the ignorance was created by a doctor, then a portion of the blame falls upon the doctor. If the ignorance was created by, you know, the parents of the person or friends of the person, then they too would be, they would have certain things happen to their soul as a consideration. So God doesn't just specifically choose the one person who committed abortion to say, right, you're treated as a murderer. God's also considering, and all of God's laws consider, every single person who has ever been involved in the suggestion to the person who's considering the abortion. So God's laws grind very, very closely, and as a result of that, these types of consequences are apportioned based on the percentage of proportion that the individuals involved influenced the person who committed an abortion.
Thanks for elaborating on that, because that was the next question.
Sure.
So thank you.
Yeah.
So we've determined that an abortion is just it's an unwanted pregnancy for whatever reason.
Yes.
Are miscarriages, stillbirths, and preterm births also just unwanted pregnancies?
It's an interesting way of viewing an unwanted pregnancy. Like, so let's consider the abortion. Abortion is a choice made by one or both parents to take away the life of the individual. It's a purposeful choice made. And because the parents themselves are making that purposeful choice, of course, that is the severity of the consequences related to that. With regard to a miscarriage, and most parents who have a miscarriage do not want to have an abortion in their mind, and in their feelings, they have a feeling like they usually badly want the child. What they don't realise is that their unloving emotions being projected at the child and the intensity of these emotions may actually cause the child to not be able to sustain a connection with its own body while it's in the womb. So in a way, it is a termination of a kind caused by the parents' emotions, although the parents themselves are probably completely unaware of what emotions that it is that is causing the problem, and therefore completely ignorant as to the underlying cause. So God certainly doesn't treat a miscarriage in exactly the same way as an abortion is treated in terms of the apportion of consequences. However, we need to understand, and this is where I feel knowledge on the planet is severely lacking, we need to understand the reasons why miscarriages occur and also stillbirths occur and so forth. And once we start to understand the reasons for these particular events, then we can resolve them completely. We can actually make sure they never occur. But that would involve the parents addressing some of their underlying unloving emotions that they have projected at the child throughout the pregnancy. And for many parents, there is a deep unwillingness to address those particular emotions, although some of those emotions do come out after the child has miscarried. Many times the emotions of the mother are expressed then, and some of those emotions are a lot about the mother not feeling like she can ever be a mother, and like a lot of them are quite selfish emotional reasons why the mother grieves. And that's a part of the release process of why the miscarriage occurred anyway. So if we look at the entire picture, every single thing associated with a child passing, even after they're born, is related at some point to some emotions inside of the parents. So if the child had an accident, if the child had a cot death or some other thing, they are related to the emotions of the environment. And if we understood that without judging it, then we'd be able to resolve the problems of the environment and therefore resolve all of these particular problems that a woman may have with pregnancy.
That's why we've never been able to resolve cot deaths.
And miscarriages and many other things. You know, there's not a large understanding on the planet as to why a woman miscarriages, for example, when it could be quite easily determined once a person factors in the emotional projections going at the child from the parents and the role the child has before it's even born, that the parents begin to establish. And these particular things cause harm to the child, of course, and therefore that the child can't sustain its own energetic connection to the bodies, and therefore the bodies themselves die. And it's the soul that maintains the energy of the body, even inside of the womb. The soul of the child maintains the energy of the body inside of the womb. And if we had a better understanding of all of these things from a scientific perspective, then mankind would be able to easily resolve much of these problems that are associated with pregnancy and childbirth.
So that all of these little souls, the ones from abortion or miscarriage or stillbirths or prembirths, when they enter the spirit world, have they degraded from their point of conception?
Certainly. Every single one of them have degraded from their point of conception, as has every other person who has ever lived on the planet who was not in a condition of atonement with God whose parents were not in a condition of atonement with God when they were conceived. And on this planet, that's every single person who's ever lived on this planet. So in that regard, these children have not been any different to any other person who's ever lived on the planet, in the sense that by the time the child is born or passes before birth, they have absorbed to a large degree already some of the emotional and belief system injuries that are out of harmony with love and truth, and therefore they have some damage which is, you know, and that's created the degradation of their soul in comparison to the condition they could have been born in. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Multiple pregnancies.
When you say like...
Triplets.
Triplets, twins, yep. Yes. Yep.
If one or more of those siblings miscarriage mm-hmm. throughout the pregnancy, mm-hmm. does that have an impact on the sibling that survives?
To a degree, but nowhere near as much to the degree that the parent's emotion has.
Okay.
So for example, let's say a person conceived twins and they were genetic twins.
Yeah.
That attaches, that means that two souls come to those two little bodies. So then there's two souls associated with the mum's pregnancy. And let's say one of those twins was a male and one's a female. And mum and dad have different emotions towards the female than the male that cause the female to miscarry. The other one will still be carried full terms, but it will carry the same kind of emotions towards the female as the parents actually have. It's just that because it's a male, it won't miscarry because it's not feeling those emotions towards itself. So every single pregnancy, and it doesn't matter how many children, you know, are created through the process of conception, so it might be two or three or four or whatever, and how many are attached to the little bodies of the developing child, will all absorb both parents' emotions of injuries and pleasures and things that are in harmony with love as well. So it's not just the disharmonies with love, it's also the harmony with love that's also absorbed by these little developing children. And if we understood the relationship with all of them, we'd understand why every single miscarriage ever occurred on the planet. And every single woman would be able to understand why a miscarriage occurred, and therefore would be able to understand how to repair such a thing so it doesn't occur in the future. Mm-hmm. The problem always, I feel, gets back to judgment. You know, there is so much judgment and there's so much desire in many women to be a mother that they that they won't look at themselves and see what emotions they have towards their children. And many, many mothers in particular have very, very strong emotions towards the children that validate their existence, the mother's existence. And these are quite damaging emotions because the child's not being loved when it enters the world. It's being drawn from or taken from emotionally. And these are all problems associated, that cause problems associated with pregnancy, childbirth, and also after childbirth, what happens to the child after birth.
Thank you. Look, last week we agreed that adoption was the best option. But we didn't elaborate too much on that. So I've got a question here. When a child's given up for adoption, what law of attraction influences are at play to what kind of adoptive parents the child will have?
Well, firstly, there is a lot about the law of attraction then of the, well, the soul condition of the adoptive parents. They obviously have a desire to have a child, and yet they cannot conceive one. So first, there must be a group of emotions associated with the lack of being able to conceive. And there are also a group of emotions associated with desiring the child, which may be quite pure. And so that there they finish up drawing a particular child to them through this adoptive process in a very similar way to what the pregnant mother drew a little soul to her when she conceived, in the sense that her soul condition and the soul condition of her partner at the time determined who would actually enter that little body that had been conceived. And so it's not much different for the adoptive parents. The only difference is that somebody else has already attracted the little child for a period of 9 months, and during that period of time, the emotional injuries of the birth parent or parents are going to have an influence upon the child. So the child will then have a little bit of a mixture of emotions. That some of it will come from its adoptive parents, and some of it will come from its original parents that gave it away at adoption. And also, it is capable, a person who has a child and carries a child full term and then gives the child to another couple, it is capable for that person to love the child during that process. Mm. So we're not saying by any means that, you know, that kind of a process would be a bad thing to do, like a surrogacy of some kind. But we have to bear in mind that the emotions of both sets of individuals involved, firstly in the conception, the first couple involved in conception, and the attraction to another couple who desired the conception and the child, have an impact then upon the child. There's now four people associated with or linked to the child's development during that time. So that does have an effect. Of course, if all of those four people were loving, it would only have a positive effect having four people loving you compared to having two. And so you can see that it just depends upon the attitude of the parents and the adoptive parents as to what would happen with the child.
Look, my next question leads us into a full discussion on contraception that I skipped over in part one.
Sure.
So why the need for contraception? And are our bodies functioning today how God intended them to be?
Let's answer the second question first. Are our bodies functioning today the way God intended them to function with regard to sexuality?
Yep.
The answer to that is no. And perhaps we really need to explain how God intended the body to work. The way God intended the body to work was when the woman in particular had a desire to become pregnant and also was in a loving relationship with a person who desired to be a father to the pregnant child, then she would be open to becoming pregnant. So in other words, she would not need contraception because under no other circumstances would she be able to conceive. So that's if she was in a pure place of love. She would not be able to conceive in any other condition. In fact, she can even control the ovulation process. So at the moment, that process happens for most women every single 28 days. And the reason why it happens is because most women have this underlying emotional injury which has a demand upon them that they only become a woman in the full sense of the word after they've had a child. And so there is a huge societal definition of when a woman becomes a woman. And for many women, it's only after have a child that they perceive themselves to be a completed woman.
But that's becoming younger and younger.
It is, and the main
society today.
That's correct, and this is because of the multi-generational projections upon women and girl children, in that there is this very, very strong belief that until in society that you're not a complete woman until you've had a child, and for this reason many women become able to become pregnant at very, very young ages, they begin ovulating at very, very young ages, much younger than it has been historically, in fact. And the main reason for this is because of this underlying idea that they'll get approval through the process from somebody, through the process, and usually from their own mothers, through the process of becoming pregnant. Now, this is not an intellectual fault inside the person. It's an emotional injury that controls how the woman then, how the woman's body works. It also is related to desires of wanting sexual intimacy before emotional intimacy is established. And as sexual intimacy is desired at younger and younger ages, this causes the sexual functioning of the body to mature at younger ages as well. And so if we didn't have so much of a focus on that, and society is becoming more and more sexualized, unfortunately, so therefore people are becoming more sexually able to procreate at younger ages, and this causes many of the problems that we face as well on the planet. So if you look at the underlying causes, we see there are many emotional injuries, and I've only just listed a few of them, but there are very complex emotional injuries associated with why a girl becomes ready to be pregnant at a much younger age than her emotional maturity would dictate, and why a boy even would engage in the act causing the pregnancy when both the father and the mother are not at an age where they could emotionally cope with giving love to the child. Now, I'm not saying that we cannot be developed enough at a young age to give love. What I'm saying is that most of the human population has been severely degraded in their ability to conceive what love is. And so therefore, you know, unfortunately, many people, even at 12 or at 80, still don't really understand love, and for that reason, don't understand how to really give love. Now, so I'm not separating a young person from an old person in that discussion. But these particular things impose problems onto the body, in that the body becomes ready for pregnancy and engages in pregnancy usually before an interperson feels they're intellectually capable of such, but unfortunately their bodies and their emotions, and many times it's the emotions of their environment, drive the action and also the underlying result. So what we need to do is address those underlying emotions. In a pure state, we would not be able to get pregnant unless the woman had decided she wanted to ovulate, and she would decide that in an emotional way by having a desire to have a child that wasn't present before then, that was pure and in complete harmony with love. So in other words, it's not a desire to have a child for the sake of herself or to give herself anything. It's not a desire to get approval from anyone else externally, but it's just a pure desire to give love
to
the potential child.
And it has to be a desire on both parties?
Yes, yes. Obviously for the male, the same applies, and then a pregnancy could occur. Under the conditions where those, in an ideal situation that God created, under that condition, that would be when a pregnancy could occur. And also those couples would actually be mates of each other, soul mates, in other words, two halves of each other as well. Mm-hmm. And it could only occur under those particular conditions.
Thanks for that.
So when you add all of the conditions that God originally intended, there's quite a lot of conditions that would result in a normal pregnancy. And therefore, it's highly unlikely that adoption would ever occur, or any pregnancy that would be unwanted. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But what's happened is that mankind has severely degraded from that condition, and because of the different laws of science that apply to the area based on the soul, there are different laws that impose themselves upon the soul's through the soul's condition onto the whole process of sexuality, as they impose themselves upon all other processes that we have on the earth. And that causes a change where what we now accept as normal and everybody in the planet generally accepts as normal, including the medical profession and the scientific community and so forth, is actually quite an abnormal state created by a whole group of emotional circumstances and situations and belief systems about love that if we actually purified, we would not have any of those particular problems, which is quite incredible when you think about it, isn't it?
It is, isn't it? I was just thinking also, because of the numbers in dark places in the spirit world are getting larger and larger, is that impacting on this situation on
Certainly.
Earth as well?
Certainly. There are many problems caused by spirit who are what you would classify as earthbound. And, of course, many of those problems are related to sexual intercourse because many of them cannot engage in sexual intercourse freely in the spirit world. And so what they do is they overcloak individuals on Earth and cause them to engage in sexual intercourse, oftentimes when they are not ready. And these spirits have a part to play in all the unwanted results of that particular overcloaking as well. Once they come to terms with what they've done, they then go to the spirit world into a certain condition and they don't bother the Earth anymore. But unfortunately, there are about 22 or so billion spirits in the condition who they are bothering the Earth every single moment of their life, pretty much. And so there's 22 billion other people who are in quite dark conditions influencing what happens with regard to sexuality on the Earth.
Did you say billion or million?
Billion, yeah.
Wow.
So it's about three times the world's current population who are earthbound in the spirit world. Yeah.
Wow. Okay, then. So on to contraception.
Sure.
Is any form of contraception lying?
No. There are some forms of contraception which terminate the child, and so therefore they are not loving. There are other forms of conception that don't terminate the child, but they have degrees of unlovingness in them. So if you look at all forms of contraception at the moment, there is a degree of unlovingness in all forms of contraception. However, let's clarify the issue a bit further.
Okay.
When we examine everything, we can see that the human race is generally in a degraded condition at the soul level with regard to sexuality, with regard to many other issues, emotional issues, and belief systems too. And we're in an unloving condition in many of these areas. So we do have to work through the area of what do we do when we're in the unloving condition. It is certainly more loving to prevent a pregnancy than it is to engage one and then abort the child.
Mm-hmm.
So it is far more loving to have contraception that prevents a pregnancy rather than a conception that actually occurs because no contraception was used and then the child is not wanted. So can you see there's a degree of unlovingness that we need to look at? And all forms of contraception have degrees of unlovingness involved in them. If we take the pure state, which is the woman would only ovulate if she had a pure loving desire to have a child with her soulmate, who's also her partner. That's the only time she would ovulate. The male would only, allow the process of conception as well under the same circumstances. In other words, he would not engage sexually women who were not his soulmate and who with whom he was not having a relationship with. So under those circumstances, we can see that that's the purest form of contraception.
Mm-hmm.
That's the contraception that God designed. So every other type of contraception is a contraception that mankind has designed because we can't obtain that pure form of contraception yet because we don't understand how it works. And so every other form of contraception has a degree of unlovingness. Now, what we need to do is look at the degrees of unlovingness in each form of contraception. The most unloving form of contraception is a contraception that occurs where that is really after the child has been conceived. So something like the morning after pill, for example, which is a form of contraception that is obviously already terminating a child. So that's you could say, the most negative form of contraception that we could use. And then there's other forms of contraception. Now, some of the forms of contraception change the female's body. Since they change the female's body and the female's hormonal systems, they are to a degree unloving towards the female. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. There are other forms of contraception that cause that are, that require a modification of the male's body or the female's body. Mm. Both forms of contraception are to a degree unloving because it requires a surgical procedure.
So you're talking about a tubectomy or a vasectomy.
Exactly. Yeah. So they require a procedure upon those bodies, and therefore there's a degree of unlovingness in those particular forms of contraception as well. So, and like I said, we can look at the entire range, and we've got the most pure condition way over here, which is the way God designed it to be, and the least pure, which is a murder in the end. And then we've got contraceptive forms all the way through those particular things. Now, again, if we look at all of these things without judgment, it is more loving to have contraception than it is to have a pregnancy that's unwanted, because straight away the child is unwanted and it feels these terrible emotions of being unwanted and unloved immediately. And so, you know, it is far more loving to have contraception than it is to not have contraception and have unwanted children instead. So this is where, you know, I can't agree with certain religious institutions who feel that all forms of contraception are unloving, because if you compare the feelings of the child and you start factoring in the feelings of the child into the actual process, we can see that the feelings of the child are fairly important consideration. And it's far better to prevent a pregnancy than have a pregnancy where the child is not wanted.
Mm. Right. Okay, so that confirms that then. The morning after pill is not ethical. That was the question.
Well, you could say yes. From if we're looking at God's viewpoint of moral ethics, then yes, from God's perspective, it's not ethical because it results in the taking of a life that's already been established, albeit for a very short time. And as a result of that, there's no respect of life in that particular process. The prevention of a pregnancy obviously still is preventing a life, but at least it is determined by the parents to some extent, and it doesn't affect any child because the child is yet to incarnate into that body because there was no body created. And so for that reason, since there was no body created in the womb or the beginnings of a body created in the womb, no incarnation takes place. And if no incarnation takes place, then there's no child affected by the fact that because there's no pregnancy.
So that leads me to the next question then. So if we're talking about the morning after pill, and there was no conception that occurred, okay, so what's the implications of that? I'll give you an example. If someone takes a morning after pill, and they're not pregnant, i.e., they didn't terminate a pregnancy through this act, what is the consequences upon their soul for making that, taking that action?
Well, they still wanted to take the action, and they still did not want the pregnancy. And therefore, you've got to also consider why they even wanted to engage sexually with the person they engaged sexually with if they did not want the pregnancy as well. So there's all sorts of issues that raises. So there's still a degradation of their soul condition because of their intention. Mm-hmm. And as a result of that, there are consequences to the degradation of their condition. So just because, and this is what I said in the first century very frequently on many issues. For example, in the first century I talked about adultery. And I said, a man just looking at the woman so as to have lust for her has committed adultery in his heart. So what God's laws judge, if you like, they don't actually judge much. They're just laws that apply that give consequences when they're broken. But what they do is they confront any unloving behaviour on our part in our heart, which is not the same as unloving behaviour that we actually perform. Mm-hmm. So if we have unloving behaviour in our heart, that is the beginnings of what we finish up doing. Now, many people do finish up doing what is in their heart. And so once the act is committed, there is a more severe consequence, of course, for the act being committed than there was with the act just being imagined. But even so, the fact is the desire to act out or even imagine an act came from the heart. And the fact that I actually took the pill, the morning after pill, is an indication that I was willing to terminate a child, and therefore there is a certain consequence to that action.
Thank you. Well, that covers everything from last week.
No worries. Okay. That's good. Yeah.
So I'd just like to share a little bit with you and get your feedback on. Since part one, I've used some mediumship to connect with the two souls that I boarded.
Yes.
One 38 years ago and one 33 years ago.
So one's 38 years old, one's 33 years old.
Yeah.
Yep.
And
what genders were they?
The 38-year-old is a male,
yep,
and the 33-year-old is a female.
Right.
The 38 was with my first husband, and the 33-year-old is with my second husband.
Yep.
And the second one is the same as my child who's on Earth's father.
So you later had a child.
Yes.
And who's now what age?
18.
So he was born 15 years after.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So it was a really emotional experience, and I didn't really expect it. It just all happened.
You mean the communication with these two little souls that are now not little souls?
But they're not little souls, they've although one's choosing to be a little soul.
Of
this
course.
Is a question I wanted to ask you as well. Look, two celestial spirits came forward and asked, was I happy for them to present my two children? Well, I become a bubbling, dribbling mess from then onwards for the next 2 hours.
You started going through grief and feelings of sorrow.
The first thing I felt, AJ, was total shame.
Right.
It was shame that I felt initially.
So shame of having taken the action of aborting them?
Because of now I know what the act has done.
Yeah.
The shame just overwhelmed me, and I really, the children were there, and I couldn't look at them.
And so initially you felt so much shame that you couldn't even engage in the children that were brought to you.
I had to put my hands over my eyes.
Yeah. And can you see the celestial spirits were helping you go through this process of repentance, which includes first feeling shame and then feeling about the reasons why we did such things.
Yes, And look, you know, it was a beautiful process, and it was very gentle, and it was very loving and very caring.
Yeah.
My son, who was the oldest, and his name's Jonathan, said that he was angry with me.
Yep.
He's not in a dark place, but he had a lot of sadness around him.
Yeah.
And because they had celestial spirits with them, they obviously aren't celestial spirits either. I've made that assumption.
Sorry, your aborted children
are
not celestial spirits yet.
Yes, because they had celestial spirits bring them to me.
That's correct.
Yes, I made that assumption. Jonathan had some questions for me.
Yeah.
He did say that he was angry with me and wanted to know why I made the choice that I did to abort him.
Yeah.
And I told him the reasons as honestly as I could how I felt at the time and the decisions, why I felt I made it, and that I didn't know any better at the time, and I know now that's not an excuse. And I said to him, you know, I'm not making any excuses whatsoever.
Can you see though that that's not the reason?
No, it wasn't the reason.
Yeah.
Yes.
And he's looking. See, one of the things that people who pass over are often looking for is the actual reason.
Yes.
Not the reason we would like to tell ourselves, or the reason that we tell ourselves to avoid the actual reason.
I told him I was really afraid. I said I was afraid of losing his father,
right?
As by me, as my partner at the time.
Yes.
Yes.
Because his father didn't want him at all.
No.
Yep.
No. We were both very, very young, 17.
Yeah, 17.
Yeah.
And you were afraid of losing the relationship.
Yes. Yes.
And that was your primary.
That
reason.
Was the primary one, and then the next primary one I would say would be my family.
Right.
Facing my family, my father in particular.
Right. Yeah. So
and the shame that would bring to my family, my father.
Being pregnant because of being
out of wedlock.
Out of wedlock.
And at a young age.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep.
So I told him those things. And then he said, ask why there was no love at the time of conception.
Yeah.
I found that was a very interesting question.
Yeah.
He actually felt that there was no love.
Yeah.
And he wanted to know why that was the case.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And do you understand why that's the case?
I don't, AJ, no.
This is the problem with two people who are having a sexual relationship who have no desire to have children at all. At the time of conception, the first thing the child feels is that there's no desire for them to be in their life. So there's no love flowing from the parent to the child. And this is why it is quite damaging to conceive if you don't want to have a child, because the child itself at that moment does not feel love flow to it. And its very first recollection of life is unfortunately no love.
Mm. Yep. And he said that, yeah.
Yeah, it's very hard to deal with. And that's why many people who have been aborted or even had no love at the time of conception spend many years in the spirit world resolving that, attempting to resolve that issue emotionally. Yeah.
I must say also at this point that Jonathan couldn't look at me.
So he was angry enough to feel sort of rageful towards
me. He didn't have his back totally to me. Yep. He was side on, but he couldn't face me at this whole time.
And can you see the celestial spirits brought them both to you, not only for your sake to help you resolve some issues, but also for their sake to help them resolve some outstanding issues as well.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. And then the next thing Jonathan shared with me, which was... which made him the saddest, I think, of everything, was that he knew who his soulmate was.
Yes.
And I was not far from his soulmate.
Right, so you knew of his soulmate as well?
Yes, and that was the next question. I said, do I know your soulmate? And he said, yes.
Right.
He said, your soulmate is amongst your group.
Right.
And that saddened him. The grief that I, you know, had then that...
And this is one thing that we often do not consider when we terminate a child, is that we do not consider that they actually have the other half of themselves remaining on Earth. And because of that, they now have to spend the first 60 or 70 or 80 years of their life waiting for the other half of their soulmate if they soon find out who that person is. So once they find out who that person is, they have to actually spend 70 or 80 years waiting. And this is quite a sad thing that they need to go through, unfortunately. So these are all what you would call the unconsidered results of termination.
Oh, look, honestly, the overwhelming impact of that on me at the time when he said that.
Yeah.
I mean, I've got a lot to feel about it. I'm just trying to hold it together today. But he said his grief about that
is quite large. Yeah. Well, it's not only large because of his grief, but it's also large because he can also feel your emotion that you don't want your soulmate.
Yes.
So there's
I spoke to him about that.
Yes.
Yes.
And that is an additional reason why he has so much grief.
Right.
Because he's actually feeling from his mother that the male is not wanted.
Right.
Make sense?
Yeah. He then also had grief around Mitchell.
Yes.
Not being a brother for Mitchell here.
So he's good 20 years older or so than Mitchell, isn't he? 23 years older.
Yeah.
And so, you know, obviously they could have had quite a good relationship.
And he could see that. And I could actually feel at a soul level that they had a similar kindness about them, actually. Yeah.
And if we explain to people who are listening, Mitchell is your son now, who you did give birth to and is now 18 years old.
So he had grief around that. And I said to him also, look, Mitchell would have grief around that as well if he knew, you know, because Mitchell always wanted a little brother.
Yeah. And a lot of times what happens is the aborted children do hang around their siblings. Because they do spend time together in the sleep state, so it's highly likely Mitchell would understand he's got a brother in the sleep state, just not understanding it in his awake state.
That's interesting, because maybe that's why he spoke so much of having an older brother all the time as a young child.
Yes, because he would have known as a young child that he did have an older brother, and he would have been spending time with his older brother in the sleep state. So every time he goes to sleep, he would be spending time in the spirit world with his older brother.
Yeah.
Then when he comes back here, he feels the loss of his older brother. And that's why Mitchell would have a feeling of loss about his older brother.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yes, yeah. I spoke to Jonathan when he was talking about his soulmate, about what you've been teaching us about the sleep state, and that he can have a relationship with his soulmate in the sleep state. And he says the celestial spirits are just teaching that to him now.
Yes. Yeah.
So he's been introduced to all of those things now.
Yes, so he is capable of actually having a relationship in the sleep state with his soulmate. But unfortunately for his soulmate too, she might not be that conscious of that relationship.
Yeah.
And she may finish up entering other relationships on Earth because of her sadness about the sleep state experience compared to the awake state experience. So it affects many people. Like, it doesn't just affect the parent, it affects the child, but it doesn't affect just the child, it affects the soulmate of the child, and it affects any siblings of the child, and so forth. So that there is a much wider viewpoint that mankind needs to understand as to see all of the emotions involved with the termination of a pregnancy.
Yeah. What I realised after that was that I could really see how God's plan was perfect.
Yeah.
And my actions
interfered with this perfect plan.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So while God's plan would still probably come about in the long run,
yes,
and through this process that you're going through, in the short term, we have interfered with the plan that everybody be happy and that everybody go through life on Earth to a large extent so they can learn a lot of things and join up with their soulmates while on Earth and learn things that way. So, yeah, we've interfered with a lot of that happening. And once we understand it's not just the gift of life we've interfered with, but rather the ongoing life, not just of our child, but also of our child's soulmate, then we start to see the full impact of what's actually happened for our child.
Yeah. At the end of that with Jonathan, he was able to look at me.
Yep.
He said he felt much better.
So he dealt with some grief.
Yes.
Yep.
He said he felt much better and he was able to go, and he was happy to go and with the celestial spirit and feel.
Yep.
So, and that was wonderful.
Yeah.
With Misha, my daughter.
The daughter, 33 years of age.
33 years of age, and the image I got was of a 33-year-old person, really a younger version of me.
Yeah.
But somebody, she was coated in love. That's the feeling I got from her. Mm. You know, she just had this, and she was actually laying on my stomach with her arms around me.
Right.
But she chose to be a little girl still.
Right.
She said that... she was a little girl, and I asked her, was she still in Summerland? And she said no, that she goes there often though.
Yeah.
Because it's so much fun.
It is fun.
Yeah. And I said to her, I asked her why she chooses to stay a child and why doesn't she want to be an adult? And she says, because being a child is a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
And the celestial spirit stepped in then and says, well, she has her own free will and she's able to decide what she wants to be.
Exactly. And she has that viewpoint, though, of a child being a lot of fun because of some of your emotions.
That's what I was thinking. Yeah.
And some of your emotions are, once we become an adult, we have to take responsibility. We have to act grown up. We can't maintain, we can't do any childlike things. And because of that, those emotions that you have, there is this influence upon her to where she goes, if I grow up and become like Mummy is, then I don't want that. So I'd rather be a child, and I'd not understanding she can act like a child while being an adult. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So
if I dealt with those emotions,
yes, you would have an influence on her. She obviously is able to work through those emotions without your, without you acting, you dealing with those emotions yourself. But it would be much easier for her to deal with those emotions if you had dealt with them. So, because that you're the influence upon it, remembering that they were both late term abortions,
yes,
and therefore you have already imposed upon them quite a lot of your unhealed emotional injuries. So if you think about it, much of your life you've been trying to grow up before your time.
Oh, I always put my age up all of my life.
Exactly.
Until I got to 50.
Yeah, and now it stays there, or does it go down?
No, it stays there.
Stays there, doesn't it?
But I've done that all of my life. If you know anybody asked me our age, I always added 5 years to it.
Exactly. And that's your desire to be an adult. And the reasons why you desire to be an adult need to be considered. And once you have a look at some of those reasons, you can see there's quite a lot of reasons. There's not just one or two reasons, but there's quite a lot of reasons. And if you can address those reasons, then you do no longer influence her into trying to remain as a child. She will also come to see that she can have exactly the same emotions and have exactly the same fun, but in a bigger body. And in fact, a bigger body actually gives you more option for fun. Unfortunately, most people in the spirit world who want to remain children still have a lot of influence on that by their parents who are on earth at the time.
It was very, very overwhelming to speak to both of them. Misha said to me that I asked them, did they know about their brother here? And they both said yes. They both had spent some time with him.
Yep.
They said they didn't come here very often.
No, they spent time with him when he's in his sleep state.
Okay.
Because there's not a lot of love for them coming on earth and spending time with him.
Right.
He is not conscious of them in his awake state. And therefore, he's lost consciousness, I should say, of them in the awake state. When he was young, he had a consciousness of both of them in his awake state. But usually, as parents, we suppress that as well. So the child who is still on earth gets suppressed quite markedly, and eventually by the time they're 10 or 11 or 12, they're expected to have grown out of any imaginary friends and so forth. And so a lot of their relationship then in their awake state with siblings who have passed is terminated. While they're on earth, it's not terminated when they sleep. They can still catch up because they're fully conscious that they have brothers and sisters in that state. So as Mitch has grown, he's become less conscious and less conscious of them being around him, and therefore there's nothing in him to draw them to him. And because of your own avoidance of the emotions regarding the terminations and so forth, there's nothing in them that would draw them to you either.
Yes.
And so for that reason, they would have very little time that they would spend on earth.
They said that I asked them had they met each other before, and they said they had seen each other around me, but didn't know why.
Exactly.
And this is the first time they'd met each other.
And this is also an interesting thing when you think about it, is that unfortunately children who are terminated do not know that they have a sibling who might have also been terminated.
Right.
So I know of some women who've had over 30 terminations, and the entire 30 children do not know of each other because there's no way of them knowing about each other unless they exercise a desire or unless the mother exercises or the father exercises a desire for them to know each other.
Yes.
So this is something they miss out on. They sort of miss out on knowing their other, their other siblings, if you like.
Yeah. Look, Misha also said to me, I asked her a question because when I was pregnant with Mitchell, I was convinced up until a month before he was born I was having a girl.
Right.
And so I asked Misha the question, was she around me when I was pregnant with Mitchell?
Yeah.
And she said she tried to come back.
Yes, she tried to reincarnate.
Yeah.
Yeah. And what she tried to do was she tried to overcloak the bodies, the material body, the physical body of Mitchell inside of your womb. And this is the main reason why you felt it was a girl. Because her soul was actually more developed than Mitch's at the time, you would have felt her as the dominant influence connected to your womb. And this happens a lot on the planet,
really?
Barbara, where many people try to reincarnate and try to re-experience life on Earth. They go through this process where they try to overcloak a child in the womb, and many succeed because of the mother's and father's belief systems. Many succeed in overcloaking the child, even to such a degree that the development of the sexual organs of the unborn child are influenced by their influence. And this is very, very damaging. It causes much confusion sexually, often, to the child. And if it doesn't cause confusion sexually, it certainly does have a lot of influence on the disposition of the child after their birth. So Mitch is always going to have a very strong connection to pleasing women as a result of this overcloaking.
He does.
And
he does. Yeah. Wow. Thank you for that.
Which is obviously damaging for him.
Yes.
It's something that he will need to work through. So this whole process of attempting to reincarnate by overcloaking the physical body of a person has huge consequences for the spirit and for the person on earth as well. And so, you know, if you can talk to Misha at another time. And it's interesting even, isn't it, her name?
I know.
The feminine form of Mitchell, if you like.
Yes. And we've always called Mitchie.
Yeah.
Always.
Yeah. And even that is very much influenced by her trying to attempt this overcloaking and reincarnation.
But she has definitely moved a long way forward since then.
Certainly. Yes. You know, she didn't have too much success with that. She found a male's body instead, which she couldn't connect to, which caused her to disconnect from Mitch. And so, you know, soon after he was born, she disconnected from him.
I, through my bubbling, dribbling mess, you know, this was all going on, I said to them that before they left that my prayers would be that they had God in their heart.
Yeah.
And Jonathan didn't comment on that, but Misha said, I have God in my heart and I know Jesus is there helping you.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I thought that was very beautiful.
Yeah, so she is obviously decided she wants to follow the divine love path, and she's discovered it through this process of her own, you know, like that she's gone through. But Mitch is still undecided. Your eldest Jonathan is still undecided, and the reason why he's so undecided is because of some of the hurts he feels.
Yes.
But that's a part of the reason. You know, there's also his father's influence. You see, in all of this channeling, you have not understood the father's influence to a large degree.
Well, I asked them, did they visit their father? And they said they tried a few times.
Yeah.
And they lifted it there.
But you haven't discussed with them the emotional impact of the father's feelings upon them and how they felt about that. And that has a large impact upon them both as well in terms of their decisions and what they choose to do with their life in the spirit world.
Okay. Well, hopefully I have an opportunity to speak to them more, and that, you know...
Yeah. It's always a good thing, because if you can engage this process as a mother, and also I recommend it to fathers as well, to engage the process as a parent of any abortion that's happened as a result of your influence. Because if you do that, you will actually heal a lot of emotion within yourself. The desire or the feeling that you have a right to take a life has a lot of underlying emotional injuries associated with it that are out of harmony with love.
Mm.
And once you engage the process of talking with the people that you've actually terminated the life of here on earth, you start to engage the process of repentance and also start to heal a lot of these underlying emotions and feelings and belief systems that are out of harmony with love through the process. So it's a really beneficial process for everyone involved.
Yeah, I definitely felt that.
Yeah.
I also feel as if maybe I shut the process down at one stage too, because I got violently ill. I was vomiting, and I think I just didn't want to face the shame. Is that what that is?
Yes, and the fear or terror that you have associated with it too. You know, oftentimes we have deep feelings of sickness once we come to the realization of what we've done, and sometimes on earth we don't want to go through those feelings, so what we do is try to shut them down. It's far better if we can keep them open. They'll pass if we allow them to pass. If we shut them down, then it will just take longer for those feelings to pass.
So, reflecting on all of that, in what situation would it be dangerous or damaging or even unwise to connect with our children in the spirit world through mediumship?
Obviously, I don't believe there is any situation where it would be damaging or unwise. However, there are every one of these children that have had an abortion, that have been a result of an abortion. Every one of them are nursed through this entire process by celestial spirits generally. Now, these spirits will generally prevent the meeting between a parent and a child if there is no love or even rage coming from the parent. So if the parent's going to project rage at the child, or if the parent is going to not go through a process of repentance, then usually the child and the parent are prevented from meeting for the child's sake. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
A very similar way to, if you think about it, if a parent on earth was abusive towards a child, then it would be wise for us to prevent the parent from meeting with the child. Otherwise, it would just have an opportunity to perpetrate the same abuse. Does that make sense? And that is taken one step further in that the abuse is considered to be emotional as well as physical in nature, in the spirit world. So if there is an emotion coming out of the parent towards the child that is very, very unloving, then usually they will be prevented from meeting until such a time as the mother and father individually wish to go through the process of their issues.
Okay, thank you.
Just can we just stop for a minute? No, we don't have to. Who was that?
It's Pierce.
Oh, okay. Just things happening. So do we have to say that again? What were we saying?
It was about the damage that we could cause if we engage this process, and you were talking about, well, you know, even on Earth we would remove a child away from its parents.
Yes. So as long as we understand that principle, there are times if the parents who involved in the abortion were to continue to have exactly the same attitudes they had at the time of the abortion, then it's highly unlikely those children, even when they are grown, would be led to the parents to have a conversation or have some kind of interaction emotionally.
Yeah. So for my children to be able to come forward now, it's because I now am experiencing a willingness to feel and own up to what I've done.
Yes. Okay. You are much more open now. Even you desiring to do this interview was about you wanting to resolve some of these issues emotionally for yourself and understand in a complete form what had actually happened. And that in itself is a demonstration of a desire that you have to change something. And under those circumstances, the celestial spirits would definitely recommend the reconnection of the aborted child to its mother or its father if the father was going through the same process.
Okay. Thank you. So a few hypotheticals.
Sure.
You ready?
Let's go.
Okay. If a woman came to you, AJ, and she was a single parent of four, she was in poverty, had no family, friends or community support. In fact, she was deemed a complete write-off by society, and she was feeling totally powerless, hopelessness, self-loathing, deeply ashamed. All of her previous pregnancies were fraught with medical issues, and she was contemplating an abortion.
Yeah.
What would you say to her?
I would always recommend them to continue, and I would then personally do everything I could to make sure that the abortion didn't take place, in the sense, like, I would make her life easier, I would choose to support her somehow if I could, I would make her life easier in terms of trying to help her work through the reasons why she gets sick during pregnancy in particular, and also, you know, try to provide or have some way of providing for her. And if we look at it from a society perspective, there is a lot we could do for this woman. And I'd encourage her to continue to have the child. And if she's having too much difficulty with all of her children, even be happy to look after the children and even billet the children out so she can work through many of these issues. So I don't see a mother I don't see children being given to other people to look after at any age as a problem, whereas people on the earth
obviously do.
Yeah. So that's the issue we have.
So it's that judgment coming in.
It's the judgment coming in again of what, and many mothers with four children, for example, or more, obviously are under a huge amount of stress, and yet society does very little in many cases to assist this particular stress. And unfortunately for many of the children, as a result of that, many of the children grow up with difficult emotional problems, which then turn into problems in their adult life that often turn into violence and other type of related problems as well. So it's very, very important to be able to, from a society perspective, but also from an individual perspective, be able to help a person. But I would never recommend to them that they have an abortion. And I would actually never encourage it on any way, because I'd want them to listen to this interview, for example, so they understood the entire, you know, the ramifications to their own soul, to the souls of the child, and everybody involved. If they understood the ramification, and then they chose to have an abortion, I wouldn't help them have an abortion, and I wouldn't recommend anybody to help them have an abortion. But it's up to them what they choose to do in the end. It is their own. It is their life. What they choose to do with their body, but. at the end of the day, they're not just doing it to their own body. So they would need to severely consider the consequences, I feel. And so if a person was really seriously considering it, I would be quite direct about what a lot of the consequences are. Just like if a person is seriously considering suicide or murder, I would do exactly the same thing. I would try to present to them the consequences of their action before they took it.
Okay, if I was contemplating having an abortion whilst pregnant, mm-hmm. but didn't, gave birth to a daughter, can that have an effect on her own decision later in life when she decided to have an abortion?
It will definitely have an effect on her later decisions in life, and indefinitely with regard to the honouring of the gift of life, the sanctity of life. So the fact that
that's even passed on.
That's now passed on to her, yes. She now has a lower degree of the sanctity of life within her generally than she would have normally have had. Or she'll go into complete rebellion, and she'll go completely opposite of that. She'll become militant about the sanctity of life. And when I say militant, she'll be prepared to kill somebody for the sake of keeping life sacred, which is also a problem. So either way, she will have an emotional problem that she will need to address. And that will be as a direct result of the mother carrying the child and considering abortion during the carrying of the child. If parents understood the amount of beliefs and emotions that enter the child during the first 9 months of the life on earth, most parents would be, well, probably initially horrified, and then after a while they would be overjoyed, actually, because once you work through the horror of it and you realise that you then have to, if you can go through the process of refining yourself before you become pregnant, then it just brings a beautiful life, possibilities and perspectives to the unborn child who is then eventually born. So if we understood the whole ramifications of the feelings and choices and decisions we make during that time of that time period, and the ramifications it has on the rest of the person's life, we would definitely not be considering abortion at any time, even intellectually, through the process. And we would want to resolve all of those questions before we even became pregnant.
True. Hindsight.
Yes, it's easy in hindsight, of course.
Isn't it, eh?
But this is where I feel, on many issues on the planet, the lack of truth and the lack of understanding on the planet as to what has really been designed by God is causing large amounts of long-term difficulties of which we must deal with the effects of. And this is a very damaging thing that we're engaged in on the planet. We are so resistive to discovering the truths of the soul, and yet at the same time having to deal with more and more of the consequences associated with breaking the laws associated with the soul and what the soul chooses to do. And if we understood the effect on our own children that our soul has during the time of gestation and pregnancy, we would be absolutely mortified to actually carry around many of our emotional issues that we currently are totally accepting of, and in fact many times justifying to ourselves with keeping.
True. If I had an injury that I only wanted perfect babies,
yes.
And a lot of us have that injury,
yes.
And I had an amniocentesis to
yes.
check all of that out,
yes.
And I was convinced myself that if it came back with a negative result that I would abort the child, but it came back positive and the abortion didn't have to occur,
yes.
What impact does that have on the...
It has a huge impact upon the child of needing to be perfect all of its life.
Yeah.
And as a result of that, you understand that many children have this feeling nowadays that they have to be perfect all of their lives, and therefore they have generally a large degree of anger because it's impossible to be perfect, particularly when your parents have imposed all of their unhealed negative emotions and unloving emotions upon you during the time that you've been in the womb. It's obviously going to be impossible to be perfect as well. And so because of the discrepancy between the fact that you desperately want to be perfect but find it impossible to be, there will be a large amount of self-criticism generally, and potentially a large amount of anger inside the person who's born. And so, yes, all of those feelings have a very large effect on the unborn child and therefore it, the rest of its life.
Wow. What about the soul condition of the parent?
And the soul condition of the parent is that it's willing to commit a murder in order to maintain perfection,
yeah.
which is an indication of the soul, of the parent's addiction to perfection.
Yeah.
And it is a major problem for the parent in that it's, if we're willing to murder for any reason, including for something being not perfect, then there is also a higher likelihood that we will create imperfection sometime in our life, including the possibility of genetic imperfection in the womb while the child is developing. And so, unfortunately, these addictions to perfection and looks, the way everything appears to be, actually create more problems during pregnancy and more problems with deformation during pregnancy than would have normally have been created. And in fact, there is a direct correlation between the desire to be pregnant, to be perfect, that occurs in almost all of humanity now, particularly in the Western world. There's a direct correlation between that emotion and the increasing incidence of deformations and genetic mutations occurring before a child is born. Again, scientifically, people do not understand why we in the Western world have an increase of knowledge with regard to the human body, while at the same and an increasing refinement of things like diet and understanding of minerals and vitamins and so forth, while at the same time we have increasing problems during pregnancy and childbirth. And if they could see the correlation between these increasing emotions and the problems that are being experienced during pregnancy, then they'd see a direct correlation, which we could then scientifically analyse and understand. And once we scientifically analyse and understand, we have the ability to solve it and resolve the issue. So all problems of genetic mutations during the process of gestation are caused by some kind of emotional injury occurring, including the process of things like where certain chromosomes are missing at the time of conception. They are all a part of these particular issues.
Wow, that's another huge topic in its own right.
Yes,
isn't it?
Yeah. And a huge topic for the medical profession to research, I feel.
Yeah.
Like, during our discussion, you can see that there are literally hundreds of topics that this would trigger if in scientific research, if doctors and scientists were willing to investigate these particular options of understanding the link between the emotional makeup of the environment, which of course is dominated by the parents, and how that, what effect that has upon the unborn child.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, if I offered support to, say, my son's partner, mm-hmm. who were pregnant and were considering an abortion.
Yeah.
I said I wasn't in favour of the abortion, but I would give them my blessing because they had free will to make the choices that they wanted to choose.
Mm-hmm. Can I address why would you give them your blessing?
In that I would honour their free will. Yeah, so blessing's the wrong word, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Yes, because, yes. You know, it is one thing to honour a person's free will,
yes.
but in this case... Yeah. There's a third person's free will that needs to be honoured just as much as the other two.
Yes.
And this is what, and also there's this gift of life that needs to be honoured. And the reality is those two people already have the gift of life, whereas if they take away the life of the unborn child, they're taking away the gift of life from the unborn child. So I would make it very, very clear to any of my children, which I have done to my own sons, that any form of abortion is very, very dangerous to their own soul condition, but also very damaging to these children, and help them understand what emotions these particular children go through. So secondly, I would also address the issue as to why they take contraception lightly if they didn't want to have the child in the first place. So we see this happening quite a lot nowadays with young children or with teenagers. They take contraception very, very lightly, and yet at the same time have no desire to have a child.
Mm.
And this is a lack of responsibility that the children have developed. And where did that lack of responsibility come from? It obviously has to have come from their own parenting, so that during their own childhood, their parents have somehow given their children this lack of responsibility if they've grown up with that particular issue. So there's quite a lot of issues that particular scenario brings up, I feel.
Yeah, and then also too, what about the impact on, if I was giving the advice, on my soul of giving that advice?
Certainly, if you gave the advice that was to, if you said to them, oh, I don't agree with abortion, but you have my blessing,
yes,
then it's almost like a tacit approval to go ahead with an abortion. I couldn't give tacit approval to a person going ahead with abortion.
Yeah.
Under no circumstances can I see an abortion being being, you know, the right way to go, because of the different things that we've discussed in the last two discussions. But I do acknowledge there is a right of the parents to make their own choice in the end. I can't force them into making a different choice. But I feel quite strongly that if they make a choice in disharmony with love, that it's going to cause a lot of damage to themselves and to their child. And I would be very firm about that particular issue. Now, I wouldn't rave on about it after I've discussed it.
Yeah.
I'll just leave it in their place. And I wouldn't reject my children because they make such a decision. So in other words, I wouldn't ban them from coming into my home because they've made that decision. Just like I wouldn't ban my child from entering my home if they were, you know, a murderer either. I would, though, it'd be one of the first issues I address with them if they walked into the home. Does that make sense? So for that reason, it's highly unlikely they'd want to come to my home because they're going to have a discussion most of the time about the issue.
Mm.
And I feel that is important, because it's important that everyone on the planet understands the significance of what their choices are, and in particular, the significance of choices that harm other people. And so it would be the same if you were alive, Barbara, and I noticed somebody wanted to murder you. I would treat that issue as seriously as I'm treating the abortion issue.
Mm-hmm.
I feel the two issues are identical in nature. Mm-hmm. I don't see them as a degree of severity, but the abortion is a minor mm-hmm. issue. And so what would you do if your son contemplated a murder? Would you give him your blessing?
Mm. No. But is that because we haven't considered on Earth that a baby in the fetus is a human soul?
Exactly.
Is that purely on that?
And in fact, the idea that you'd give him your blessing comes from you yet to go through this understanding that actually, no, this is a little child. Even when it's in the womb, it's
yeah.
a child.
Yeah.
At the moment, the understanding is, I feel, on the planet is very poor, in that it basically only views the child as a child once it's born.
Yeah.
Or going through the childbirth process.
Yeah.
And other than that, it doesn't treat the child as a child.
Yeah.
And this is a major moral and ethical issue. That
see, having that knowledge, it just changes everything.
It changes everything. Yeah. But you also have to consider, why is it that it is so hard for people to get that the unborn child is still a child?
Yeah.
Why is that so difficult to grasp? There's got to be some very strong emotional reasons why that is so difficult for a person to grasp. And yet the instant the child is born, now they accept the child as a child. And in fact, the actions taken towards one by same doctors even is completely different. A doctor will often almost vitamise, if you could use the term, I know it's a fairly rough term, an unborn child and kill it using that method. And yet many times the same doctor is completely willing to put into a human crib a child who is, you know, being born through the natural processes, and try to keep them alive and spend hundreds of thousands of dollars of all of our resources keeping them alive.
Mm.
And it's very, very interesting, this deep contrast between those two states.
Mm.
So my feelings are that on this matter is that, firstly, we need to prevent all unwanted pregnancies. In other words, we need to stop the conception for any person who is engaging in sexual intercourse. We need to stop the conception, because if the person conceives a child, then already the child is feeling bad, already. So we need to stop conception. Now, in the cases where there's some kind of accident and the conception cannot be stopped, then we need to allow the child to go full term and not judge the parent for it, no matter what age the parent is, no matter what the circumstances are, because we understand that we all have some injuries associated, not just the parent, we all have some injuries associated with the unborn child. then when the child goes to full term, we should not judge the parent for giving away that child if the parent feels like it cannot cope with, you know, looking after the child or giving it the love that it needs. And we need to find parents, and there are literally millions of parents who desire to love children, who would love to accept these children. We need to make it easy for those parents to accept it, and instead of this legal minefield that we make it, we also, if everyone loved, we would also need to allow later that the original mother or parents may wish to see the child, and therefore allow such a thing to occur without worrying about whether we're going to lose the child now. And oftentimes adoptive parents are so afraid of losing the child through that process because they themselves couldn't have their own child, and that was the original emotion why they couldn't have a child, was they were afraid of losing children. And so we have this ramification of all these different emotions playing out right from the moment of conception or prior to conception with the sex act, right the way through to childbirth. And if we could resolve them all and experiment with it scientifically from an emotional perspective, then we'll find the answers to lots and lots of questions all through this, and a lot of ethical questions would also be resolved.
Wow. Well, AJ, after part one and part two now and my mediumship experience, I've decided now that, you know, I'm going to focus on dealing with my feelings, with my shame and my grief about, you know, what I've done. And all the unloving acts that, you know, were at play at that time. So in saying that, what advice would you give me in handling that? And when would I know that I was fully repentant? So what would I have to get to?
Well, firstly, I'd just love to compliment you on having that desire. That when a person has that desire to address these issues, you'll be surprised how many things inside of you, emotions inside of you that have been unloving, will be addressed through this process. Does that make sense? And the fact is that if you had passed into the spirit world before now, one of the very first issues you would have had to face would have been this issue. The act of murder would be a very strong, like, realization after you passed in a certain condition. You'd realize that, wow, there's a reason why I'm here. And that would have provided some motivation to deal with this as the very first issue in your life. Interestingly, because of this issue, there are many different emotions and belief systems involved. And as you resolve these emotions and belief systems one by one, you will actually find that a lot of your other rest of your life will also change. Does that make sense? So your attitude towards men will change, your attitude towards women will change, your attitude towards life will change, your attitude towards embracing desire will change, and so forth. Your reflections upon the gift of life will change. Your desire to act every day rather than put things off will change. Everything changes once you work through your way through these groups of emotions.
How do you know I had all of those emotions?
Well, it's pretty easy to feel a person when you can feel them, right? So once you go through these issues, this is the beauty of doing what you're choosing to do, is once you start going through these issues, a lot of the other problems of your life will also be resolved, because many of the other problems of your life are being caused by the same soul condition that attracted these events in the first place and caused you to make the choices you made. And this is the beauty of addressing these issues in the manner you are while you're on earth. So I would recommend to any person who's ever been involved in having abortion, any person who's ever done an abortion, to work through these issues. And if they work through these issues, and remember, you need to work through them without judgment, you need to work through them emotionally. And if you can work through those issues, there is so much of the rest of your life issues that you will resolve in working through these specific issues associated with the taking of a life. Yeah. So that would be my recommendation, is to not give up until it's done. You know, not to put it off because some of the emotions will be hard. And some of the emotions will be hard. And to engage God in the process, you know, through this process of repentance. Engage God's help when you feel like it's getting hard. If you address these issues, much of the rest of your life will change, and even the lives of your unborn the aborted children who are now in the spirit world will actually be affected and change, particularly if they've yet to resolve the underlying emotional issues as to why the abortion took place and their own lack of understanding about it. So you have the power to not only affect, by addressing these issues, to affect your own life, but you have the power to affect the, in a positive direction now, because remember, you've affected in a negative direction two lives.
Mm-hmm.
You've now got the power to affect in a positive direction these two lives. And you've also, remember, you've affected, there's the soulmates of these two people. So you've actually affected in a negative direction four lives, mm-hmm. and you have the power to positively affect those four lives in a positive direction if you address the emotional issues associated with why these actions were taken. So I feel it's wonderful, Barb, that you desire to take those actions, and I also feel that it would be wonderful if every single person who ever even considered abortion, let alone had one, would actually address those issues. I would also love to see any person who has ever had a miscarriage or any other problems during childbirth and during pregnancy to begin addressing at the emotional level what really went on without judgment. Without judging themselves for having the particular issues. Remember that a lot of our emotional issues, just as a lot of yours have, come from our parents. So they are imposed generationally from parent to child, parent to child, parent to child, and often over many generations. And so we need to stop judging them. We just need to repair them. We need to stop passing them on to the next generation. And all that you can do to resolve that particular problem will change what happens around us. So you imagine if 50 women got together and did that, who had all had an abortion. Imagine the effect that would have around them of the respect for life straight away. That would change. And imagine if 1,000 women, and imagine all the men who have ever wanted their wife to abort or wanted their partner to abort a child. Imagine if they all got together and examined their particular problems and reasons why they chose to do that, their attitudes towards women, their attitudes towards the unborn. If they address those particular issues, imagine what kind of change could happen on the planet with that kind of change happening in the hearts of people. And so this is why it's always beautiful to see a person do what you're beginning to do here, and that is to bite off an issue that is challenging emotionally, that you've wanted to resist for a lot of your life but are now brave enough and have enough courage to actually address.
Yeah, I hope so.
So that would be my recommendation.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And full repentance, you will definitely know when you get to that stage.
Yes, with regard to full repentance, you will actually be able to remember the events completely. You will be able to just talk with every single person about it.
Mm-hmm.
Any person you even haven't met, even a person who knows nothing about your life, you will be able to speak with your children who are in the spirit world openly. You will be able to have a relationship with them. And when you have all of those things happening, you will understand that you are now fully repentant.
And you'd be able to clearly see the reasons why you took those actions.
You would not only clearly see the reasons why, but you would have addressed them emotionally. You would have looked at the belief systems and you'd have addressed those emotionally. And inside of you, you would have a completely different feeling about abortion. And you would never then be able to say to your son, oh, I'll give you my blessing, you know, or yes. I respect your right to decide. While we do respect the rights of other people to decide what happens to their own bodies, at the end of the day, this is also about respecting the right of a third party who has yet to have a voice. And they also need to have their rights respected, if you like, or the gift of life respected.
Yeah.
Remember, we've all been given this gift of life, and that gift of life should be a gift that any single person who is conceived is given the choice to choose to do what they want to do with it. As soon as we take away from them that gift, it's like imagine if we had a Christmas tree, we had a brother and a sister. The brother takes his gift and he uses it, and then with his sister's gift, he gets out a baseball bat and destroys it. How would you react as a mother then? You'd be quite mortified. Well, that's what we are often doing. We've been given the gift of life as parents, and then we take away the gift of life from our unborn child. We don't have that right to make that choice and decision. It's a gift, and if we acted in harmony with love, we would actually allow the child to experience that gift.
without taking it away ourselves. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Thank you, AJ. Now, that advice you just gave me and every other person who's considered an abortion or had an abortion, would you give that same advice to our spirit friends?
I would give the same advice to every... There are many millions of women spirits who have arrived in the spirit world expecting to arrive in relatively good condition, but have arrived in very bad condition because they have aborted a child. And as I've said to you, the consequences of that are treated very similar to murder. And many of these women are very surprised about that. And so I would recommend exactly the same thing to those groups of women. And also there are many men who pass in the spirit world who have thought they've lived a nice, honourable life, and yet they've encouraged their partner or their wife to have an abortion, and they've arrived in the spirit world in a very dark condition, in a similar condition to a murderer. And those men do not understand, and they need to work through the emotions of understanding that they're forcing their wives or having a huge emotional impact upon their wives or partners to consider abortion is the reason why they remain in such conditions. And if you consider how many abortions are done every year, basically at the moment, like you said, statistically, there were 44 million abortions every single year, and that's probably... That's a light estimate of it, but that means there's 88 million murderers every year. Now, I'm not even sure if there's that many murders on the planet in terms of other murders.
In terms of numbers. Yeah.
If you think there's 88 million people who are murderers every single year on this planet just from this issue of abortion, obviously that makes a huge effect on not only the planet itself, in terms of the condition and the feelings about life on the planet. This is why we have so many feelings about life. We treat life without any respect on this planet generally. This is why we easily enter into wars. We easily enter into oppressing other people because we don't understand the gift of life. And if we all dealt with those emotions and there were no abortions on the planet, then everyone on Earth would have a far greater respect for the gift of life. And therefore, it would be very, very hard for us to go to war. It would be very hard for us to do other things that damage life. And the other thing we need to consider is that actually there are more murderers, I feel, on the planet relating to abortions than there are murderers relating to actual murder of an adult person. And that's something that we need to really consider, like in terms of a society, how willing we are to murder a person who has not got a voice compared to how willing we are to murder a person who does have a voice. And surely the willingness should be very different. It's almost completely opposite of what it currently is. And I'm not saying we should be willing to murder anybody, but what we need to do is be far less willing to murder a person without a voice. And yet we enter that in a quiet, open and willing space. And in some cases, it's like an afternoon conversation over afternoon tea, and the decision is made, and that demonstrates the lack of respect for the gift of life we have on the planet. So I would recommend to everybody listening to this who is challenged by this discussion to actually consider those particular things. If we can kill our unborn children, we can do a lot of other things that are very, very dark. And if we can't kill our unborn children, then we have a lot more respect for life. And if you consider that, for those spirits that have passed, it would be lovely if all of the spirits who have passed, who have been involved in abortion, started to work through their emotional issues and reasons of why they have taken such action. So we need to make sure we don't judge them, but they do need to work through the reasons why they did not value life. And some of those reasons will be relating to their parents, and some of the reasons will be relating to the society they lived in, and so forth. And we need to address these issues as a society so that we can have a society where, from the moment of conception, a child is protected, not from the moment of birth. And that would be wonderful.
Thank you, AJ.
Thank you again, Barbara. Bye. Yeah.